Hello friends, welcome to Akulmec Live. I'm Kanchan Verma, and in this episode we have a special guest. He is an Indian bureaucrat who has a deep interest in Mahatma Gandhi's philosophies and ideologies. As you know, Mahatma Gandhi is world's greatest political and spiritual leader. We'll be discussing about his principles, his ideologies, and how these ideologies and principles are relevant in today's modern time. So stick around to this episode till the end. It is very interesting episode for you. Hello friends, welcome again. And you know, today we have a very distinguished guest with us. He is Mr. Mukul Kumar, who is a distinguished and very refined bureaucrat. He is also a very popular novelist and poet. And he's been honored with the National Award for his outstanding service. He's also been awarded Bharat Nirman Award for Literacy and Excellence. So without wasting any further moment, I would like to welcome him. Welcome to our show, Mukulji. How are you doing today?
Thank you. I am fine. And very good evening to my viewers. Very good morning to my viewers also.
Well, it's our pleasure to have you, and I know that you are very a very good student of Gandhian philosophy and ideology. So, you see, what you really mean with Gandhi, and how this Gandhism is to you? What do you mean really about Gandhi as a person or as an ideology?
Well, I won't claim that I'm some scholar on Gandhian philosophy. It's only that I have been a student of history, and that way I have been I have had the opportunity to study Indian freedom struggle. And when you talk of Indian freedom struggle, I think Gandhi emerges as the most crucial figure. Coming to Gandhi's ideology or philosophy, whatever you can say, like Indian freedom struggle itself reflects what Gandhi is. I would like to break his ideology or philosophy into four major segments, like social, cultural, political, and economy. And if you really study Indian freedom struggle with a lot of care, you will realize that Indian freedom struggle is not a very not something like monolithic. It is a very broad-based struggle. And it encompasses the social, cultural, political, and economic aspects, even environmental aspect. And all such issues are still relevant today with which humanity is grappling. Let me explain to you, like coming to the social aspect. Like Gandhi's struggle started with from South Africa, all of us know that. And it started with his fight against racial discrimination in South Africa. He formed the National Indian Congress, and his being thrown out of the compartment, first class compartment, went on to create history, And his struggle started with fighting against racial discrimination. National Indian Congress he formed in South Africa, and that fight against irrationality, against any sort of discrimination, got carried throughout Gandhian struggle. If we place him in the context of India, then he fought against untouchability. He was against the irrational discrimination on the basis of caste. Gandhi vouched for communal harmony, all of us know, and we are still grappling with this issue, Hindu-Muslim ideology. And that his passion for communal harmony went on to give rise to a movement like cooperation movement. Then coming to the gender issues, with which India, this issue is still relevant, that we are fighting for the rights of women. We are trying to bring about equality, between man and man, the man and woman. And Gandhian, struggle right from the beginning, if you talk, Gandhi wanted to co-opt women also, without any discrimination. And I'm reminded of a quote by Gandhi that he says that the day woman would be able to walk alone at night, that would be the real independence. And see, I live in Delhi. I know the state government is still striving, taking all such measures to ensure that the women are able to move out at night safely. Gandhi is still relevant even in the social sphere today. Coming to the economic aspect, you say, economy. What? Let me tell you the best economic model which has emerged in the current times is regulated capitalism based upon the concept of welfare state, where we talk about, you know, inclusive development, taking care of the last man in the queue. And if you really study Gandhian freedom struggle very carefully, while he was fighting for the political freedom of the country, he was fighting for the economic freedom of the people at large also. His agitation against the British Empire, his movements like Champaran, his movements like Kheda, his movements like Swadeshi, you have to understand, place in the very large context. Swadeshi, when he saw that the British goods are flooding Indian market, supplying the cheap material, the very cheap material to the British Empire, and importing the goods, is driving many people at large unemployed totally. Artisans, our small scale industry, they were lying in ruins. Same with the farmers. Then Gandhi, that was the basic driving motive, behind launching the Swadeshi movement. And that is what we are still grappling with, the major issue of unemployment. Gandhi was for the production for the masses. He wanted that production should be able to cater to the needs of the people, not mass production for the sake of mass production, mechanization for the sake of mechanization. That way Gandhi is still relevant, today. Coming to the cultural context, Gandhi always talked about that you have to, now I am reminded of his Hindu Swaraj, where he says that he talks of the concept of self-rule. Self-rule is what? He explained self-rule. It is ruling over the self. That implies control over the self, awakening of the soul force, awakening, moral enhancement. And he realized that in the Hindu Swaraj, he talks that we have to ensure that when we get the freedom, we are not going to create an English India. He put before the people the flaws in the Western civilization, which is completely lopsided based upon the material pursuits of the material ambitions. He was equally concerned with the spiritual development of the individual, awakening of the moral force. He knew that India, he wanted to tap upon the indigenous concept, indigenous resources of the country, and he wanted to strike a balance between the material aspiration and the spiritual development of the individual. That is how Gandhi, and when we talk about political, all of us know he wanted to give the freedom, but his concept of freedom is very broad based. You have to understand it in totality.
Well, I always appreciate Gandhi ideology because he's one of the greatest leader, political and spiritual leader of the world. And what happens that I have read, and one of the aspect of his ideology is non-violence, which I really appreciate. And at one point of time, he said that on this earth, everything is available, is given by the Mother Earth. Whatever is a human require, but it is not for the greed. So I think, that way I think it makes Gandhi different from any other leader, political or spiritual leader. So I would like to ask you now, what makes Gandhi the great Mahatma Gandhi?
You raised a very pertinent subject, Mother Earth can provide for everybody's need, but not for everybody's greed. And you see, this is the most burning issue in the world we are living in. We are talking about sustainable development. We are utilizing the resources of the earth much in advance. What we should utilize, what we should be utilizing in 1 year, we are utilizing in much lesser time. And that is why this concept of earth overshoot day has come into limelight. Sustainable development means not putting the unnecessary pressure upon the natural resources, utilizing it in a very judicious manner, and try to gradually resolve the conflict between environment and development. And Gandhi's this quote that we can provide, Mother Earth can provide for everybody's need, but not for everybody's greed, I think it speaks volume. And this is the most, that is why I'm telling, Gandhi is equally relevant today. Gandhi's concept of non-violence, be it truth, be it non-violence, be it empowerment, be it economy. I'm absolutely floored by this man, what kind of visionary he was. Coming to your basic question of what makes Gandhi Mahatma Gandhi, as a student of history, and especially I have had a passion for, Gandhi as a subject itself. Gandhi is, Gandhi is a discipline in himself. He remains the most enigmatic, most towering personality of the human history, according to me, if you ask. What makes Gandhi Mahatma Gandhi is his basic ingredients, of course, were there in him, but assimilated to genius of Gandhi. Gandhi took all good things from many people around him. Like, I will illustrate it with the example, the thinkers who have really inspired Gandhi and shaped his personality. I will start with the name of Henry Vivid Thoreau. He was an American thinker, and Gandhi imported from him the concept of, civil disobedience. Thoreau wrote, Duty of Civil Disobedience. And Gandhi started his struggle with civil disobedience in South Africa. You see the man, and then coming to Tolstoy. From Tolstoy, he took the concept of bread labor. Bread labor, where he treats the hand labor with the hand, with lot of dignity. And he says that everybody has to undergo physical labor in order to earn the bread. And when he created the ashram, when he set up the ashrams for the country, he ensured that each and every resident of the ashram is able to contribute in one way or the another to the upkeep of the ashram, to the maintenance of the ashram. So he was equally keen on the physical labor also, which he took from Tolstoy. Second thing which he took from Tolstoy was that Tolstoy's famous book is there, that the kingdom of God is within you. And where he says, love is the law of life. And Gandhi loved humanity at large. Every action of Gandhi reflects how he loved humanity when he says his service to man is service to God. His love for humanity becomes palpably obvious. Then the man who most influenced Gandhi was John Ruskin. His book, Unto the Last, which he read during his journey from Durban to Johannesburg, he read that book, and from there he took the concept of social trusteeship, where he talks that I am not against an individual earning the wealth, amassing the wealth, provided he puts it to the use of the welfare of the people at large. And that is the concept of trusteeship. The money you earn, you are just trustee on the behalf of the people, and you are putting that money to the use of the people so that everybody's need is met. The best of communism he took. While he was not a proponent of communism, he took the crux of the communism, the most humane aspect of the communism, and put it to, and he was equally concerned with the individual aspiration. So he encouraged individuals earning of wealth also pursuit of the material aspiration. So that is regulated capitalism based upon the concept of welfare state. And this is the best model of a state which the modern world has adopted. Communism has crumbled. Unbridled capitalism has crumbled. How it crumbled in 1929, Great Depression of America, you saw that unbridled capitalism failed. So he was able to strike a perfect balance between capitalism and communism, and came out with a perfect model, the best model which we have experimented with so far. Then another scholar which influenced no end was Ralph Waldo Emerson. Ralph Waldo Emerson talks of self-reliance. And Gandhi was in the favor of our villages functioning as a self-reliant units. And already we have started talking about smart villages. He showed the darker side of the urbanization, and he knew that the soul of the India lies in villages. He was very well alive to that particular aspect of the Indian social and economic fabric, and that is why he was all for promoting villages as the basic unit of society and the economy. And that is where I think we have missed the bus, and now we are waking up to that reality, and we are talking about smart villages. And as an individual, I really feel more than smart cities, we need smart villages also. So again, we have to strike a balance between the village and urban setup. Gandhi is like, to me, I think Gandhi, if you study him very carefully, I'm telling you, I think he was a complete leader. He was a complete leader.
Well, you have really mentioned very well when you are taking us to smart cities and self-reliant villages. You also mentioned the way of administration, which Gandhi really visualized at that point of time. And I think he is far ahead of his time when he is talking about these aspects, these ideologies.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So
Gandhi was like, he was such a humble person that he openly confesses that he was a great man, but he was always eager to take good things from people around him, from the events around him. That is what makes you really great. Assimilative genius.
So actually, as you mentioned that we were talking about how relevant his ideologies or his principles are in today's scenario, because we are really developing very fast. But we are lagging behind in social front, economic, and sometimes political front also. And you may be remembering that we had a G7 summit. We discussed about the Mother Earth and how to cure it. So all these points are very, very relevant. And I think Mahatma Gandhi had that kind of vision and that kind of country he wants to make. And few of the points is being taken by the current government in the development aspect, in the implementation of some of the aspect of Gandhian philosophy. Now I would like to ask you what Gandhi really means to you as an individual.
Gandhi for me remains a subject of eternal interest. My interest in Gandhi never, and I don't miss any opportunity of knowing more and more about Gandhi. To me, he means a complete individual, a complete person. And if you ask me that, have you seen God? God, when we talk about God, we associate God with some kind of miracle or some kind of supernatural force. But Gandhi as a human being, I feel he was a divine human being, in the sense that his only pursuit in life was humanism and goodness. He goes to the extent of saying, I don't want any conflict between economics and ethics. He wanted to create a political system based upon individual, where you have each and every action of yours should have the sight on the last man in the queue. He talks. You see the human history, if you observe the human history, it has been the development of or growth of reason. Reason in Gandhi was always there. He put it to practice. That is another hallmark of Gandhi, when he says that an ounce of practice is worth 1,000 words. He first practiced and then he led by example. Gandhi, what more can I say? I treat him to be a complete individual, the most towering personality, and I would call him a godly man. Who was born in the and Albert Einstein, I'm reminded of Albert Einstein. The coming generations would hardly believe that there ever walked upon earth a man like Mahatma Gandhi. So you can say just Albert Einstein's statement speaks volumes about Gandhi. What more I can say?
Yes, well, actually it is a very, very crucial topic and very, very crucial subject to be discussed and to be propagated when we are talking about Gandhi. Though we know so much, we study about Gandhi so much in the school, but I think on a very lower level, maybe primary, we should get books on his principles, like non-violence, how to live, how to care about the people, like Pi Parai Jaane Re. That is one of the very strongest quotation which is being given by Mahatma Gandhi.
Right? Yeah, Vaishnav Jante, if you understand the meaning, first stanza, I will just tell you the crux of the first stanza. It is like a human being should appreciate the pain of others as if it is his or her own pain, and you should serve the person without any sense of pride. You have to understand, while service is one thing, But serving without any sense of pride that, okay, I am doing something, that was Gandhi. Complete self-effacement, that was Gandhi. Then again, I think I'm reminded of Gandhi's views on politics, where he says, when I talk about self-rule, it is not self-rule as if getting freedom from the British rule. It is like everybody is able to rule over oneself, and every individual has an equal say in the administration, in the politics. That is too idealistic, I know, to be followed. But he said, his own statement I am putting you, that I am an anarchist and I know and I will pursue ordered anarchy. The word he uses, phrases he uses, is ordered anarchy, where each and every individual is able to have a say in the administration and he is ruling upon himself. That was Gandhi. You have to go a bit deeper to understand the person Gandhi was. Sometimes, of course, he was too idealistic, he was too good to be put into any model. Gandhi was a transcendental figure. He defies any economic model. He defies any political model. And if you really want to create any model based upon Gandhian philosophy, it has to be completely idealistic, where every individual has to be good, good at heart. That is why he says the good of the individual is always contained in the good of the all.
Well, as usual, it is so wonderful to really talk to you today and understand more about Gandhi and Gandhi's philosophy. So we'll be meeting again, maybe in the next show, we'll be discussing more topic-wise, elaborate topics, so that our viewers understand how important is the principle and the ideology, and which are very, very relevant in today's time also. So once again, thanks very much.
Before concluding, I think this discourse would be incomplete without talking about Satyagraha Gandhi. I was talking about assimilative genius and hunger in Gandhi to import good things from the people around him. I think I would be missing the name of Socrates, the famous Greek philosopher, whose trial is very famous, where he was, he defended himself in a most convincing manner, even in the face of death sentence, still he never yielded. He never yielded truth. Gandhi's Satyagraha is that. Insists upon truth, fighting for it without any fear. That was Gandhi. And he put it to the practice, in Indian freedom struggle. You have to understand the second aspect of Satyagraha, where he says, the fighting for truth is one thing, but Satyagraha is also about reforming the adversary. You are fighting the sinner, but you are fighting the sin, not the sinner. That was Gandhi. I think each Gandhian philosophy comes into play in each and every strategy also of Gandhi, of Mahatma Gandhi. Whatever he said, he really practiced. And he led by example. He showed to the world, even in a political context, you can put your entire economic, social, and cultural views or philosophy into practice. Indian freedom struggle remains the most broad-based struggle to have been ever launched anywhere, I must say. And that is why Martin Luther King Jr., Nelson Mandela, all such big leaders whom we really almost emulate and worship, they have been the ardent admirers and followers of Mahatma.
Yeah, really. And you have mentioned all very crucial and very thought-provoking issues in today's episode. So we'll be meeting again the next time and discuss more elaborately, taking as any interesting topic. And I think that will be very, very interesting for our viewers to study and view the views and understand what really Gandhi means to us today. And I just want to say one thing in the end is that he is very, very relevant in today's modern era also. So take care. Bye-bye.
Anybody's understanding of Gandhi can never be conclusive.
He's right. So see you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you.